This week at the Internet Cafe, Disinformation on the Net. We'll take you to the Urban Legends website, an encyclopedia of false information on the net. Meet Robert Schafer. He runs a website that debunks false information about parapsychology and UFOs. Some information on the net comes from usually reliable corporate sources, but at disinfo.com, you'll discover these sources are not always reliable. And meet John Whalen of conspired.com. He's an expert on web-driven myths. Plus, on our Cyber Blast, we'll send you free software, Newsmonger, an automated Usenet newsgroup scanner. Disinformation on the net, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with over 10,000 PC and Mac products, award-winning service, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. www.pcconnection.com.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet here with Jane Wither, Andrew deVries. We're talking about disinformation on the net. This is a really interesting subject because the net, like, it can breed bad information. Who are you guys talking to tonight?
Well, you know, paranormal stuff is all over the net. I mean, UFOs, ghosts,
aliens,
you name it, right. There's a group out there, publishes a magazine called the Skeptical Inquirer, and it's actually a group made up mostly of scientists, even had folks like Carl Sagan before his death and things like that on there. And it really goes through and it says, you know, there is not a lot of factual information to back all this stuff up. A lot of it's not true.
So debunk some of
it. Debunk some of it, right, exactly.
Urban legend?
Yes.
All the stories that I always heard, which I'm never really sure if it's true or not.
Alligators in the sewers and things like
that. Well, alligators in the sewers. You know, that's one thing. You know, whether or not the dog that they brought back from Mexico was really a dog or it was actually a rat. You know, those kind of stories.
There's a million of those.
Yeah, a million of those. And then talking about disinformation, I mean, a classic example of that is the quote-unquote land dispute in Big Mountain in Arizona. So we're going to talk about that, too.
Okay, speaking of disinformation, the TWA plane crash, all those stories that went out on the net about missiles and the Navy
right.
and all those. We're going to talk to a guy who runs a site called conspired.com. It really takes a look at all these mysterious conspiracies that come up from the TWA thing to JFK, on and on and on. It's really going to be interesting. Disinformation on the net coming up.
So, David, you've got this great website which lists all of urban legends galore, especially some of the things that even I've heard about. What prompted your interest and how long have you been doing it?
Well, I've been doing it about 6 or 7 years since I first stumbled across the internet, and I can't say exactly why, just I found an urban legends news group and it looked interesting, and you know, I've been reading and writing about them for several years now, and about 2 years ago I decided to put up my own website so I didn't have to keep writing the same stuff over and over again.
So one of the great ones was, I see at your website, you've got a lot of information about Walt Disney and
right.
the Disney
yes.
studios.
Right.
What are some of the great stories that you've heard over and over again?
Oh, well, you know, everybody's heard that Disney's frozen, you know, that he was in cryogenic storage after he died. And, you know, he was cremated, you know, that's amply documented, but people still repeat the story, and it's a funny joke, he's in suspended animation, you know. But,
well, now, what's the scoop with the lemmings jumping over the cliff in that White Wilderness movie?
Right.
Is it true or
no? It's sort of a made up version of a legend itself. You know, lemmings don't commit suicide, but people think they do. So when they made this film, they simulated something that's not true in the first place and just kind of rounded up some and herded them off a cliff.
So is it true they actually pushed these lemmings off this cliff?
No, it's it, as far as we can tell, it is. I mean, there weren't very many lemmings in the film, and they weren't native to where they filmed it.
The things we do for Hollywood. Now, let me ask you another question. What are some of the best stories, the things that you think are the most interesting?
Well, certainly one that's going around now is about the businessman who's traveling and picks up a woman in the bar and goes up to her room, and when he wakes up later the next morning, he finds out he's got a big scar on his side and he's got a kidney missing. You know, because roving bands of organ thieves are stealing kidneys to sell on the black market.
You know. Is this the one where they say that you're lying in the bathtub in a thing of ice?
That's the
I've heard that one.
Right, call 911 if you want to live.
Right.
You know, and right now it's talked about as happening in New Orleans, and it's usually takes place in Las Vegas because that's the moral. You know, it's Sin City. If you hadn't been gambling and whoring, this wouldn't have happened to you. You know, let that be a warning.
Where's some other ones?
Oh, there's like the classic, like the woman who puts an ad in the paper. She's selling a brand new Porsche for $50. people think this must be a typo. They take a chance and show up anyway, and sure enough, she's selling a new Porsche for $50. And she explains her husband ran off with his secretary and wired his wife, sell the Porsche, send me the money. So her revenge is she sells it for $50 and sends him the money.
Right. So you don't know for sure if it's true, but everybody's heard the story.
Right. I mean, it could have happened somewhere, but...
I think what's neat about your website is that you tell the story and what the background is, but then you give the history to where the rumors started.
Exactly.
And then you back up all the information with,
right.
you know, with archived where you read it and which magazine and which newsletter and so on and so forth, which I think is great. Now, let me ask you a question. I mean, now with the advent of the internet and all of these use groups and you've heard all these stories, do you think that the internet is propagating even more of these kind of legends?
Yeah, I think so, because while it gives us an easy way to debunk them, people don't avail themselves of those resources. It really gives us a means to spread them even faster, and it even gives people who deliberately want to spread stories and misinformation a way to do it that's real professional looking, no badly Xeroxed leaflets anymore, you know. Good stuff.
Thanks, David.
Adam Tanzel, the private detective who Courtney Love hired to investigate Kurt Cobain's disappearance a week before they found him with a shotgun wound in the head, recently went public with a website funded by Billy Idol and some of the folks from The Well, making available live transcripts of wiretaps, all sorts of evidence implicating David Geffen, MTV, Courtney Love, and the entire Cobain family, pretty much showing that Cobain's death was anything but a suicide.
So Robert, you are from PSYCOP, another acronym here, but I think it's the Committee for Scientific Investigation for Claims of the Paranormal.
That's pretty close. Of Claims of the Paranormal.
Of Claims. Okay. And now tell me a little bit what that's about. It sounds very serious.
Well, we try not to take it too seriously. PSYCOP is a group that's been around actually for more than 20 years now, and it was founded by people who were concerned about the widespread, uncritical acceptance in society of very bizarre and irrational claims about psychic powers and extraterrestrials and
people love
those
monsters. People love those stories.
Oh, you bet they do.
Right. In fact, I think now we've seen just a proliferation of them. You know, we've got the movies, we've got several TV shows right now. Sort of, what do you attribute this common, you know, widespread use of this stuff now?
Well, these entertainment shows are fine, mm-hmm. fantasy is fine, as long as you don't blur the line in your mind between fantasy and reality, mm-hmm. and unfortunately a lot of people are doing that. It's so much fun to believe in these things, the extraterrestrials and whatever.
It's like, gee, wouldn't it be neat if this was true? Well, maybe it is true.
Right, right. Okay, so along comes an organization like what you belong to, and you're sort of helping people, you know,
we're trying to promote critical thinking,
right.
and in not just UFOs, but people who claim psychic powers, or they claim that your horoscope will determine your personality or can predict your future. Mm-hmm. And of course, when these claims are looked at critically, they fall apart. There
mm-hmm.
is no evidence.
Mm-hmm. Well, UFOs kind of brings up an interesting topic. I think that's one of the most, at least on the internet, widely spread.
Yes.
I think there's probably more UFO sites almost than anything.
What, yeah, there's new ones all the time.
Right. So how does PSYCOP deal with UFOs, and what do you think on that?
Well, several of us individually have taken our own actions. I wrote a book, The UFO Verdict, which has been, a lot of people have found it to be helpful. And,
What about Roswell? I mean, Roswell is kind of a story that, I mean, even it was even in the Independence Day movie. What,
yes.
What do you think about that?
Well, you know, that's an interesting story, but there's not one piece, not the tiniest piece of solid evidence that any of that is true. And what's interesting...
No bodies in the desert?
Absolutely
no.
All kinds of stories about little
right.
bodies, but no actual little bodies. And what's interesting is when you look at each of these claims that the major Roswell so-called witnesses are making, they're contradicting each other all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one says, a saucer crashed over here and there were two bodies. I know, I saw it. Somebody else says, oh, it crashed over here 200 miles away and there were three bodies.
So nobody's telling the same
story. Well, no,
the
they're not telling even the same story.
So besides obviously studying and sort of debunking these things, I imagine you become somewhat of an expert on how to create your own UFO photos, or at least how people have gone and done it on the
on the web and where else?
Well, I've certainly created enough of my own UFO photos.
So some you've
of them,
done it?
Oh, yes, and I have some of them on my web page.
Oh, okay.
And I imagine I'm using a lot of the same techniques that some of these other people are using.
Used.
Sometimes it can be just as simple as you get like a small model, like an aluminum plate, and you doctor it up to look kind of pretty and portholes on it and antennas and whatever, and you just toss it up like that. And you get a friend to take the picture.
Sounds
when
like
you
a
toss
two-person.
It up there. Yeah, you got to have some help to do
right.
that. And
so this was like a little Saturday afternoon project.
Yeah, or an evening project,
right.
and you can use a flash and
right.
get a nice picture that way. It looks a little more mysterious that way coming at night.
Right.
And others I did with a banana split ice cream dish.
Uh-huh.
I put some modeling clay across the top and then stick a little toothpick in there for an antenna. And then you have a really neat looking UFO when you photograph with the right lighting conditions.
Right. So people can do this at home.
Sure.
Well,
I think a lot of them do.
Well, thanks.
The MIBs, a.k.a. the Men in Black, for, you know, on X-Files watching people, just started a Groom Lake-based, that's the area around Area 51, Groom Lake-based clothing company called Gray Enslavement Unit as a backlash against the Schwa and Alien Workshop clothing companies, which are funded by the Gnomes of Zurich, the bankers from Switzerland that nobody can touch. It's basically this huge war about how to integrate aliens into society, and the victims are the fashion and children of today.
All right, so John, you run a website called conspire.com, which is based on your book, 60 Great Conspiracies. Or
60 Greatest Conspiracies of All Time, yeah.
What's the basic idea of what's on your site? What are you dealing with there?
Well, we're sort of a one-stop shopping place for paranoia. We basically deal in all of the conspiracies that are out there being bandied about. We examine them, we explore them. We take a look at which ones have merit, which ones don't. We have a little fun with the ones that don't. And basically it's based on the book, which gathers what are in our consideration what the 60 greatest conspiracies out there right now
all right,
are.
So give us some examples of some of the conspiracies that you deal with on your site.
Okay. Well, of course, the granddaddy of all conspiracies, JFK.
Still yes. going strong.
Still going
after
strong.
After all these years.
Yeah, like the battery, like the bunny. Basically, that one's going to be around probably forever.
Yeah.
There's so much information there that you can remix it and come up with something new every time.
And I mean, people are constantly coming up with new theories on this.
Right. Yeah, it's one of those theories that I don't think we'll ever get to the bottom of that will be a perpetual mystery.
Okay, newest thing, I guess, is TWA plane crashing?
Yeah, that's probably the hottest conspiracy right now on the web, anywhere. Basically, you've got people trading information all over the place, details that come out. What's really interesting about that, though, conspiracy theory, is that the web and the internet
really
is
web-driven,
has
it?
Kept it alive. It's brought it back from death several times.
Now, what is there about the net and the web or the power of this sort of worldwide, everybody can publish? What does that do to conspiracies? I mean, you're sort of a conspiracy guy.
Yeah, well, it's a super fuel for conspiracies. It's like gasoline
really?
On a conspiracy fire. And or another metaphor would be it's like a greenhouse where everything grows like crazy.
It's just so easy to spread stories, isn't it?
Right. There are so many connections that you can make on the web. And the web sort of mirrors the whole conspiracy mindset of connections, links. You know, hypertext
right,
is
right.
kind of like the paranoid mind at work.
Now, is there a counterbalance on the web that effectively can go against? I mean, it's so easy to spread stories. Is there anything that you think can help control that?
I think the only way to control that, the only antidote to bad information is good information and more of it.
Yeah.
And the web is just filled with both. Right now, one of the real problems with the internet and the web is it's really difficult to distinguish between the good and the bad
the
information.
Real and the fake, yeah.
And I think as time goes on, as more and more information providers on the net sort of prove themselves and others disprove themselves, I suppose, we'll have a better idea of who we can rely on. But I don't really think there's any technology that we can check.
Good speech has to be bad speech.
Right.
Later, huh?
Short of censorship, there's really nothing.
What are some of the really weird conspiracies that you deal with on your side? What's the far out stuff?
We deal with the believable and the unbelievable.
Yeah.
And as far as the believable go, those conspiracy theories, I think some of the favorites that we have are, the CIA's attempts
the
to
alien
assassinate.
Stuff?
No, CIA's attempts to assassinate Fidel Castro. That's well proven, weird, interesting stuff. But the really far out stuff, a lot of, you know, the alien autopsy, which Fox TV aired, and which took on a life of its own.
That's
a big
crash.
One. The Roswell crash is big. Anything to do with UFOs is huge.
Yeah.
We've got some other interesting ones that people are always asking about, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ being faked.
So these things go back a bit.
Yes.
And how, I mean, there's the Apollo one, right, that people believe all the moon landings were fake?
Right.
Government conspiracy?
Basically, yeah, NASA realized it could not actually build the technology to take people to the moon, but it could build a sound stage in the desert and hire actors.
How about O.J.? There's got to be some O.J. stuff here.
Well, O.J. is sort of like a conspiracy theory unto himself, blooming and growing as we talk. But O.J., interestingly enough, does connect to the moon moon landing conspiracy theory in that there's a film called Capricorn 1 that is based on this moon landing being faked. O.J. Simpson was in that film. So everything's connected.
The site's conspire.com.
Yes.
Thanks a lot, John.
Okay.
On this week's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 5 software programs to make sure you get the right information on the net. We'll be downloading nearly 4 megabytes of data in less than 120 seconds. You can actually see the files starting to download right now. To get these files this fast through the TV signal, you need a card for your computer called a TV modem. We'll tell you more about that later. You can also download these files off the web using your regular telephone modem. Download time on the phone at 288 will be about half an hour. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, a terrific utility to help you pull down just the right information from Usenet news groups. This program is called Newsmonger, and it will automatically monitor and download newsgroup postings that match your criteria. We're also sending you S-Tools. This is a clever little program that encrypts important files and hides them inside BMP, GIF, and WAV files. This is a security technique called steganography. If you want to add some spice to your own web page, we're sending you a full-featured HTML editor called Coffee Cup that includes 50 animated GIF files and 10 complete JavaScript plus a colored wizard. Finally, just for the fun of it, a boss button to help you quickly cover up any inappropriate activity that may be on your computer screen, and a game called Animal Quest that your kids will love. Remember, we're sending all 5 programs to you right now through the television signal using our Cyber Blast technology. The speed of this download is equivalent to about a 400 BPS modem, so it's a lot faster than using your usual telephone modem. If you need information on how to receive a Cyber Blast or on how to install a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at pctv.com. You'll also find information there on how to download these files directly from the net using a standard modem. So the download is just about complete. Have fun with your new software. That wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson. Jeff, tonight we're talking about disinformation, and I think you've got a classic example of just how destructive disinformation can be to a culture and to a people. Can you tell us a little bit about what the Big Mountain land dispute is all about?
Well, the perceived land dispute really has its origins in a long time ago when energy companies discovered resources in this area of Arizona. Big Mountain is northeast of Flagstaff, Arizona, and it's an area that was shared by 2 tribes, the Hopis and the Navajos. There were no boundaries between their tribes. They kind of both used this area. But the energy companies wanted to have tribal agencies that they could deal with, and they wanted to have clear lines drawn who they were dealing with. So they in order to do this and to facilitate this, they created this phony range war, this perceived land dispute. And that enabled them to go in there and grab these resources that they wanted, which is on land that was considered sacred by the traditional people on both sides, the Hopis and the Navajos in the Big Mountain area.
Okay, so again, so basically have the Hopi and the Navajo who share this common area, mm-hmm. and what's been trumped up by these PR agencies is this issue over land dispute, when what you're saying is, in fact, there is no land dispute, they share this land collectively?
Well, before they wanted to draw hard and fast lines, there wasn't much of a land dispute. And yes, this PR firm, Evans & Associates, which was working for the Peabody Coal, one of the energy companies going in there, wanting to get at those resources, Evans & Associates was able to go to D.C., Washington, D.C. bureaucrats and to the press and issue a lot of press releases trumping up this land dispute. And that's created a public perception that has enabled federal actions against these native peoples that are trying to resist further development of their native lands.
Okay, so if I understand this correctly, the whole idea of this land dispute, if they validate this land dispute to the public, then that allows them to walk in and actually legally remove these people from their land. Is that what you're talking about? That's correct.
When we see stories in the press talking about federal actions moving these people because of a perceived land dispute, what these stories don't mention is that Peabody Coal is underneath it all, engineering it so that they can get at the coal that's there. And a recent article in the New York Times mentions the land dispute and talks that up and fails to mention Peabody Coal and actions taken by lawyers representing Peabody Coal and the Hopi Tribal Council. There's a lawyer that represented both of them.
So there's a conflict right there.
Conflict of interest. None of those things are ever covered in these stories, and what is covered is this perceived land dispute.
What's interesting to say about that whole thing is that this PR agency is representing these issues, quote unquote, and therefore a lot of journalists are taking this without having actually gone to the reservation, without having actually truly understood what these issues
are. That's right.
So we as the public read this and we take this to be truth.
We take this to be truth, and we don't do anything about it. We as Americans would be moved, I think, if we thought that people were being moved off of their land for no good reason, but when we think it's an intertribal dispute, and
then it's not our issue, and let
it go, you know. And
so, what's the lesson that we learn? I mean, if disinformation is rampant, then what choices do we have? What would you recommend?
Well, you know, take it with a grain of salt. When you see the stories, realize they probably come from the desk of a PR firm, and not from a good investigative reporter. And also visit our website. We have a website that's very informative, and you can click on page after page. And that'll get you in touch with people you can really talk to down there and find out what's going on. So,
thanks very much, Jeff. This is a really important issue for us to look at.
Well, thank you.
Now, the coal mining is up in this area, but they want to expand that way. And Big Mountain is down there where those hills are. They want to expand all the way past there. And that's what we're trying to defend, and that's what this work is about. And even going that way, that fence goes directly to a mine, and you'll see these big machines digging up the land. And they're trying to deny it, but that says it all to us, even though we don't read or write their language.
So Richard, you've created a site, Disinformation, let me see if I can get this right. It's a sort of an alternative search engine for alternative media sources on the web. What's wrong with the media sources that we have right now, the ones that, you know, you and I watch every evening?
Well, every night you're going to watch a show that's coming to you from one of possibly 20 media conglomerates that control, you know, print, media, publishing, and they have an agenda when they want to give you a story,
right.
So they don't give you the whole story. And our site's about giving you the other half of that story that you might not find otherwise.
So you're saying that some of these media are controlled by other forces? I'm assuming you're talking about corporations, even possible government interests?
Sure, you have, you know, ABC, Rupert Murdoch's companies, CBS, GE, they all have an agenda when they're in their involvement in the media.
Right.
So the stories that come to you may not be the whole truth. And our site's about getting people to understand what the truth is and to find it and to make sure that they question everything that they see.
That they see, that's just on there.
Yeah.
Right. Well, give me an idea of some of the conspiracy things that may be going on or topics that are hot right now that there may be other media sources out there for people to hear about.
Well, the tobacco industry is undergoing a lot of hot press right now.
Right.
And their agenda is definitely something that people should find out what their other
right.
side of the story is.
Right. People are coming forward, actually industry spokespeople are coming forward and saying some of the things may not have been true that they were saying.
So we have a lot of some information on that and other information on the alcohol industry as well.
Mm-hmm. So I can type in a keyword and it will bring up information on these sites. Is there some kind of a rating system, some kind of a ranking that would help me determine, you know, to know whether this is a good source of information?
We try and lead people into the resources that we feel are more important or possibly have a lot more information than others. But we give a lot of links to a lot of different things of various quality. and we leave it up to the viewer to decide.
Right. I guess you'd almost have to leave it up, because if you didn't, then you may start to be able to fall victim to the same thing that some of the larger scale media could be doing.
Exactly.
As well.
We want people to understand that their job to find the truth, and not our job to give it to them.
And bring it out.
Yeah.
Right. Great. All right. Well, thank you very much.
So, really interesting stuff tonight, disinformation on the net. Did you have a better feeling for being more wary of the stuff you read?
Yeah, learning about this disinformation search engine, that there really is a huge amount of corporate control of a lot of the media in this country. There's about 5 or 10, corporations that control most of the media interest. Seeing that there are alternate sources out there, some of them very good, was very interesting.
Well, that's a really interesting point, that there is really intentional corporate organized institutional disinformation, not just malicious individual stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
What about you?
Well, I guess it's a fine line. I mean, I think that the challenge is that you realize you really can't trust anything.
Yeah.
And no matter what, you're always going to have to decipher some element of truth from all the stuff that you get. It's really impossible to know that this is the absolute truth anymore, because everything is disinformation in one form or another.
Well, maybe, but I think what's interesting about the net, it is such an efficient tool for disseminating information that it's therefore a very efficient tool for disseminating false information. I mean, there's some classic examples. There's a story of a 9-year-old kid who was dying of cancer, posted a message. This was 11 years ago. Please send me lots of greeting cards. The kid got cured. He's alive and well. He's 20 years old. He's going to college. He still gets 160,000 get-well cards every week because people are still telling this story, which isn't true anymore. So, I mean, some of this stuff really does get out of hand because the web is just so powerful. So whether it's good information, bad information, it's sure out there. Anyhow, that's our topic on disinformation on the net. We'll see you here next week again at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with over 10,000 PC and Mac products, award-winning service, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. www.pcconnection.com.